So we were had started talking about projective algebraic sets. So I will briefly review the notations and then we go on. So we had the projective space Pn, which was Cn plus 1 without 0, divided by the equivalence relation, where we have that two vectors are called are equivalent if one is a multiple of the other by a non-zero constant. The quotient space is a projective space. And then we had seen that if we have a homogeneous polynomial, we can talk about a point in Pn being a zero of that. So we say that f of, so the corresponding point here, the equivalence class is just done by the thing with with square brackets. So if P equal to a zero to a n, we say that f of P is equal to 0 if f of a0 to an of just this n plus 1 tuple of numbers is equal to 0. And this will be independent of the representative. And in the same way, now if we have a set, like in the affine case, if S is a set of homogeneous polynomials, we can talk about its zero set. It's a set of all points in Pn where all these polynomials vanish. And, and then we wanted to, we had related again, as in the affine case, these zero sets to ideals. So instead of taking a zero set of a set of homogeneous polynomials, we can take a so-called homogeneous ideal and take the zero set of that. And that, again, allows us to use a bit more algebra. So so I don't recall the definition of homogeneous polynomial. One way is to say it's generated of homogeneous ideal. One way is to say that it's generated by homogeneous polynomials. So if I in kx0 to xn is a homogeneous ideal, then we can define the zero set of I to be the set of all P and Pn such that f of P is equal to 0 for all homogeneous elements in I. Because until now, we have only said what it means to be zero for a homogeneous polynomial. And in the same way, we can associate a homogeneous ideal to a projective algebraic set. So I should say that sets of the form Z of S for some set of homogeneous polynomials are called projective algebraic sets. So, so if X is a, in Pn is a projective algebraic set, and in fact, if it's any subset, but just say for in this case, then the ideal of X is defined to be this. The homogeneous ideal of X is defined to be the set of all the ideal generated by all the polynomials f in k x0 to xn such that f of p is equal to 0 for all p in x. This is, again, also completely analogous to the affine case, but now we take the ideal generated by them because we have not said what it means to be 0 at f of p otherwise. I should say that later we will sometimes need to look at the projective zero set and the affine zero set at the same time. So, you know, the zero set of this ideal in Pn or the zero set of this ideal in a n plus 1. And then so we distinguish that. So in case of need, we call this Zp of x, of I. Okay, and the other one may be Za of I, one for projective, one for affine. And this is the homogeneous ideal, so in case of need, we call it IH of x, the homogeneous ideal. We'll see that later. So after saying that, the story that we only know what it means to be a zero when the polynomial is homogeneous, I want to immediately contradict myself and say we can also define it if the polynomial is not homogeneous, and also give the opposite answer to a query about this than I gave the other time. But, you know, it's just one can just remark or also an exercise. So if f in k at 0 to xn is not homogeneous, we can define the zero set of f to be the set of all points p equal to p in, so p equals a0 to an in pn, such that f of a0 to an is equal to 0 for all representatives a0 to an of p. So in other words, for all, so it's 0. So if we fix any a0 to an here, it must be 0 for all lambda. Lambda a0 times lambda n must be 0. So we could say this is the zero set of this polynomial. So the first thing that you can notice is, so want an exercise. So if f equal to f, say, f0 plus 1 plus fd is the decomposition into homogeneous components, then the zero set of F is the intersection from I, from over all I, in this case I from 0 to D, of the zero set of Fi. So we see that, so in some sense, if f is not homogeneous, it doesn't just give us one equation, but many equations. And for instance, if f has a non-zero constant part, it means that the zero set is always empty. Hope this is correct. okay. And now, but this is just a small thing. The actual exercise is another one. With this definition, so that the zero set of a polynomial is actually the set of all points where it's zero for all representatives, we get, so if I in kx0 to xn is a homogeneous ideal, then the zero set of I can also be written, the zero set of I as we have defined it here, no? As defined before, this is also equal to the set of all P and Pn, such that F of P is equal to 0 for all f in I. Okay? Okay. So the, you know, if we take this strange definition for the zero set, then actually we don't have to restrict to homogeneous elements. And in the same way, if X in Pn is a projective algebraic set, then its ideal, as defined here, so the homogeneous ideal is just equal to the set of all F in K x0 to xn such that F of P is equal to 0 for all F in X, for all P in X. Okay, so if we change what we mean by the zero set by saying it should be zero for all representatives, then we can use the same definition as in the affine case. But it means something complicated to be zero for all representatives, as you see here. Okay. So, but I mean, I say this just now. We will not use this very much. We'll use it once. Otherwise, we usually restrict our attention to homogeneous polynomials and work with that, because it's just easier. Okay, so now we can go ahead. So now, in basically what we want to do now, I mean today, is to repeat everything that we did in the previous lectures for the affine case, for the projective case. So with rather small differences, one can do the same things. And the proofs are very similar, so we can go over it rather fast. So, the first thing that we had in the affine case is the Zariski topology. So we want again to say that the projective algebraic sets are the closed sets of a topology on Pn. And that's very, so I just state it here as a proposition. So let's say that, so for instance, if X is contained in Y, yeah. Into homogeneous components. So we have,
yes.
Yeah. So if I F write as a sum of its homogeneous components, so this is the part of degree 0, this is the part of degree 1, part of degree d, then the zero set of F defined in this way is the intersection of the zero sets of the homogeneous. The degree is the number I put up here. So say if X and Y in the N are projective algebraic sets, then we have the first thing that say the idea of X contains the idea of Y. And the proof is in the same way, the same as before, because we just have less conditions here. I mean, if you look at the definition, this is completely obvious. So this is clear. Second, if, say X in Pn is a projective algebraic set, then if I take the zero set of the ideal of X, this is equal to X. And, you know, remember we made some proof of that in the affine case. And you just repeat the proof. It was a formal argument, which we use in the same way. In the same way, if I in K x0 to xn is a homogeneous ideal, If I then take the ideal of the zero set of I, this will contain I. And this is again obvious from the definition, because the ideal of a zero set of I is all the polynomials which vanish where all the polynomials in I vanish, or all the homogeneous polynomials in I vanish, and obviously this contains I. And do we need this? Okay. So, and it's again clear that, so for instance, if S in K x0 to xn is a set of homogeneous polynomials, then the zero set of S is equal to the zero set of the ideal generated by S. And this is just the same proof as before. It's kind of clear that the ideal generated by S contains S, therefore the zero set is possibly only smaller, but then you can see that if you write any element here as linear combinations of elements here, you see that also the other inclusion is true. And then we come to the thing which gives us the Zariski topology. These are the two things. So if I have a family or a set, say S alpha of sets of homogeneous polynomials, we find that if we take the zero set of the union over all alpha of the zero sets of S alpha, this is intersection over all alphas of the zero set of S alpha. If you think of it, this is again completely obvious because we just, there is obviously, except that there's a misprint, like this, obviously. It just means you put all these conditions at the same time, and this just means you take the intersection of the zero sets where you have only these. And then the last one is that if S and T in K, x0, xn are sets of homogeneous polynomials, then the zero set of, if I write S times T, which is just a set of all products of one element in S and one in T, notice these will be also all homogeneous if S and if all elements in S and all elements in T are homogeneous, is equal to the zero set of S union zero set of T. And this is, again, the same proof as before. If you just remember how we proved this, you can just see that, an element in the product will be zero at a given point if one of them is zero there. And that's all that goes into the proof. So in particular, if you take the last two, arbitrary intersections and finite unions of projective algebraic sets. Are projective algebraic sets. No, this is the content of 5 and 6. And we have already seen that the empty set and the whole of Pn are projective algebraic sets. So that means we have that the axioms of the closed sets of a topology are fulfilled. So we have a topology whose closed sets, a topology on Pn whose closed sets are the projective algebraic sets, and this we will call the Sarisky topology on Pn. And then every subset of Pn is given the induced topology. This is again the Sarisky topology on that subset. So let me just write this down. Yes?
Phi is not equal to the sum of ideas.
Yeah, also that. No, I didn't prove that the other time, but it's also true. It's also equal to, it's an exercise to prove that this is the same as a zero set of the sum. So all three are equal. But in the moment, I only need that, so I also only wrote that. But you're right. You can also take the sum. So this, if you want, you can do as an exercise. This is a zero set of the sum or the sum or the ideal, whatever. We'll write sum. Anyway, the ideal generated by the, you could say the ideal generated by the union, which if you want is the sum, I don't even know how I would want to write that. So maybe say, and if you want, you can call this, so the ideal, you take the ideal generated by the union of the alpha, this will give us that. And if you want, I think that's more correct. Okay, so we want to talk about the Sarisky. So I wanted to just write down the definition of the Sarisky topology so that we have it once on the blackboard, although it's obvious. So the Sarisky topology on Pn is the topology whose closed subsets are the projective algebraic sets. And as before, if X in Pn is any subset, we give it the induced topology. So the topology that so such that a closed subset of X will be intersection of X with a projective algebraic set. And in particular, we use this when X itself is a projective algebraic set. It automatically has a topology. and this is also called, then, this is the Sarisky topology on X. Okay, so we have introduced this thing. And so we will most of the time talk about so-called quasi-projective algebraic sets. These are open subsets of projective algebraic sets. So definition. quasi-projective is an open subset projective algebraic set. So these are the, in some sense, the most general algebraic kind of algebraic set, so the most general things we want to study. Okay. So the next thing that we had was the decomposition. So in the affine case, was the decomposition into irreducible components. So if you have an affine algebraic set, it's in a unique way a union of irreducible affine algebraic sets with the property that none is contained in another. And these are called the irreducible components. And so we want to see that the same is true here. And if you remember, this was done before by somehow using the fact that AN is a Noetherian topological space. So that is, if you have a descending, is this correct? A descending chain of algebraic sets, so then it terminates. And this follows from the fact that KX1 to XN is Noetherian as a ring, because if you have an ascending chain of ideals, it becomes stationary. And so we want to see that obviously that the same works here, and then we immediately get this decomposition into irreducible components. So remark, proposition. So we know that K x0 to xn is Noetherian. This is, after all, the Hilbert basis theorem. Whether we call the variables x0 to xn or x1 to xn is somehow of no relevance. So thus, it follows that the same proof as in the affine case shows that Pn is a Noetherian topological space. Maybe I will all the same repeat it, but it's a Noetherian topological space. Maybe I can. Namely, what was it? I mean, I will all the same this time. Same, it's to say it. So if x1, x2 is a chain of closed subsets of Pn, then I can look at the corresponding chain of ideals. Ix2 is a chain of ideals in Kx0 to Xn. And as this is a Noetherian, it becomes stationary. Thus, it becomes stationary. So beyond a certain n, all the I of xi are all the same. And as we know that xi is equal to the zero set of I of xi, we know that if the ideals become stationary, then also the sets become stationary. Maybe this is like this. Also, the original chain becomes stationary. So if at some point the ideals become always the same, then the zero set becomes also the same. Okay. So from this it follows that PN is a Noetherian topological space, and we had stated the other time that if you have a Noetherian topological space, then any subspace with the induced topology is also Noetherian. So therefore, any subspace of PN is a Noetherian topological space. In particular, every quasi-projective variety is Noetherian. So we have that, and then we had proven the existence and uniqueness of the decomposition into irreducible components in general for Noetherian topological spaces. So it also holds here. So we have already proven that every Noetherian topological space has a decomposition into irreducible components, and so we have it. So in particular, we have. So it follows that quasi-projective varieties have a unique decomposition into irreducible components. So, I mean, the statement would be that if we have a quasi-projective variety, we can write it as a finite union of irreducible quasi-projective varieties. And if we require that none of these irreducible quasi-projective varieties is contained in another one, then this decomposition is unique. It's precisely as in defined case. So you just take the formulation that we had in defined case and you replace fine with quasi-projective, and that's it. Oh, actually, the statement was in general for Noetherian topological spaces, so it follows anyway. Okay.
Because a variety is not irreducible.
Oh. Yeah, yeah, no. Well, I haven't yet. Yeah, yeah. So algebraic sets. So it's actually, it's a debatable issue whether varieties are irreducible or not. That depends on the author. I mean, in some books you find variety as a different word for algebraic set, and in some books you find a variety is always irreducible. So with me, a variety is always irreducible, except if I make a mistake. But if you look into a book, it sometimes is different. Depends basically on the country where the author comes from. So if you find a book in French, variety will usually not be irreducible. But if it's in English, it usually will be. So, and now actually, this was precisely the point where I was now. So definition was now anticipated, but a quasi-projective variety is an irreducible quasi-projective algebraic set. And sometimes I just say variety instead of quasi-projective variety. There is a more general notion in algebraic geometry of abstract algebraic variety, which is really more general. But we are not going to deal with it in this course, so therefore we, I don't have to distinguish from that. What else? So if we we had identified use the identification from the beginning that of the part on projective algebraic sets that An is viewed as a subset of Pn, namely An is supposed to be identified with this U0 in Pn. The set of all points like that, where the first component is 1 or non-zero, which is the same. Just by identifying a point a1 to an with 1, a1 to an. If we use this identification, we find that an is an open subset without the zero set of the polynomial x0, is an open subset of Pn. So an is a quasi-projective variety. And in fact, we get that any affine algebraic set is a quasi-projective algebraic set. Just because it would be a closed subset of this open subset of Pn. Okay. So this was as much as we wanted to say about the Zariski topology. So the final thing we had in the section on affine algebraic sets was the Nullstellensatz, the theorem of zeros. So we want to say, which gave us some kind of relation between the ideals in kx1 to xn and the affine algebraic sets, so that you can go backwards from taking an affine algebraic set, you can take its ideal, or if you have an ideal, you can take its zero set, and these are not quite inverse bijections, but you can precisely find out what the relation is. And this was the contents of the Nullstellensatz. Now we want to make a projective version of it. So we want, so this would be affine cones and the projective Nullstellensatz. So we want to prove a version of the projective version of the Nullstellensatz which gives us a relation between the, say, the projective algebraic sets in Pn as compared to the homogeneous ideals in K x0 to xn. So as before, we have these two maps in the two different directions. If you have an algebraic set, we can take its idea. And if we have a homogeneous idea, we can take its zero set. And we had already seen that in the defined case, these are not precisely inverse to each other. But but we can find out what the precise relation is. And now, however, you know, the Nullstellensatz was a very difficult theorem. We certainly don't want to prove it once more. So what instead we want to do, we want to show that the statement for projective space follows from the statement for affine space. And this we want to do by relating what happens on Pn to what happens in An plus 1 by taking, you know, taking the zero set of an ideal in An plus 1 instead of Pn, or taking the ideal of something, you know, so to, you know, after all, and how do we do? How do we want to do that? We want to do this by looking at the affine cone of a projective algebraic set. These are all points in A, n plus 1, whose class lies in the projective algebraic set. Okay, so let's do this. So we want to prove this. I mean, I haven't said what the statement is, but whatever we want to prove by reducing to the affine case n plus 1, making use of affine cones. Okay, so let me formalize this again by a definition. First, I have to say what a cone is and what the affine cone of a projective algebraic set is. So, a non-empty affine algebraic set X in A n plus 1 is called a cone . Well, what is a cone? A cone is a set which has a property that for every point it contains the whole line through the point. You know, you are in a vector space, A n plus 1 is just K n plus 1, so the whole line through the origin is contained. So for any a0 to an, lambda times a0 to an will also be contained. So it's called a cone if for all, say, p equal to a0 to an in x and all lambda in k, we have that lambda p, by which I mean obviously the vector lambda a0 to lambda an, is also in x. So that means if somehow here's the origin, and you know, we have that x contains this, then it also has to contain all the lines from this thing through the origin, and also going on the other side like this. Okay? And that's after all what you think a cone looks like, no? You know, a cone is something which looks like a cone. I mean, maybe on the picture it doesn't really look like anything, but I think you can imagine. So, and now for a projective algebraic set, we can define a fine cone. So if X in Pn is a projective algebraic set, well, the affine cone is just the set of all points in An plus 1 whose equivalence class lies in X. So this the set is, I call it C of X. So it's a fine cone is C of X, which is the set of all, say, A0 to An in An plus 1, such that if I take its class, this lies in X, and you know, you know that the class of X just depends by this up to a non-zero multiple, so we know this thing will contain for every point the whole line through the origin except for the origin. Well, that's not quite good enough, so we have to make sure that we also have the origin. And this will be a cone. Okay, so this is the affine cone. And we somehow see, in some sense, whether we talk about the projective algebraic set or it's a fine cone, it somehow, in some sense, is the same thing. I mean, we have the same information. We can get one from the other and vice versa. Well, so, well, that comes now. It turns out to be in a fine algebraic set, and I will precisely tell you now how come. Okay. So this is a lemma. So let X be a non-empty affine algebraic set, not projective algebraic set. Then there are two statements. The first thing is that if we take, so X is a projective algebraic set, so that means that X, so this may be X, we can write X is equal to the zero set, so I write now projective zero set, because I'm in projective space, of some ideal I, some homogeneous ideal I. Okay, then it follows that the cone of X is equal to just the usual zero set in An plus 1 of I. In particular, it is in a fine algebraic set. And the second statement is also how the ideals are related. So if I'm in the same, maybe I, this is a general. So the ideal, if I take the ideal of the cone of X, so this is, you know, the cone of X is some subset of a n plus 1, I can take its ideal. This is equal to the homogeneous ideal of X. So if I have X is a projective variety, we have its homogeneous ideal. And this is the same as the ideal of X. So you can see that from the kind of algebraic point of view, if you relate to an affine, a projective variety, its ideal, and go backwards, somehow the cone is basically the same as the projective algebraic set. The ideal is, you know, precisely corresponds to it. But we are moving ourselves from the projective to the affine situation. So this I actually do not want to prove. This is also an exercise. It's actually quite easy. So it's a reformulation of this previous statement that we had, that I said that if you take the zero set of that if you take an ideal, if you have a homogeneous ideal and take its zero set, so then you can either define this as the common zero set of all homogeneous polynomials in that ideal, or you can define it as a zero set of all polynomials in the ideal with a slightly different definition of what a zero set is, namely if it holds for all representatives. And it's a reformulation of this statement. But I mean, it's not completely trivial reformulation remark. But, you know, it's easy to figure it out. So now, given this, we want to state and prove the Nullstellensatz, the theorem of zeros. Projective Nullstellensatz. So, well, it's supposed to be a thing that corresponds to the strong Nullstellensatz. There's only one very small difference. So let I in k x0 to xn be a homogeneous ideal. First statement is a bit different than the affine case. So the projective zero set of I is empty. You know that in the affine case, the zero set of an ideal is empty if and only if the ideal is the whole of kx0 to xn. Here this is not quite the case. So if and only if I contains all homogeneous polynomials of degree n for some n. Okay, so if the ideal, it doesn't need to be that it contains all polynomials. It just is enough that for some given degree, it contains all homogeneous polynomials of that degree. OK, so that doesn't look very similar to the affine case. But that's the only thing which is different. So if we look at an ideal whose zero set is not the empty set, we get the same statement of the strong Nullstellensatz as before. So second, if the projective zero set of I is non-empty, then the ideal of the projective zero set of I is equal to the radical of I. Okay. And this means again that we have essentially one-one correspondence between the projective algebraic sets and the radical ideals in kx0 to xn, except that we have this tiny thing that the empty set is a little bit more complicated. So let's see the proof, and then we'll also see where this exception comes from. So we first prove one. So we put x to be the zero set in Pn of this ideal. So maybe it starts here. So well, when is x is equal to, when does it happen that x is equal to the empty set? You have to remember the definition of the, I mean, with respect to the cone. So remember that the cone of x was the set of all points in a n plus 1 such that its class lies in x union with the point 0. So x is equal, when x is equal, x will be equal to the empty set if and only if the cone just consists of the point 0. No? Because that corresponds to the fact that there's no point in projective space that lies in X, because these would correspond to the non-zero points in the cone. Okay. Well, we know that Cx, after all, is equal to the zero set, the affine zero set of I, so the zero set in An plus 1, union 0. So the fact that the cone is equal to the point 0 means that this affine zero set either was the point 0 or it was the empty set. And thus, x is equal to empty set if and only if set of I is equal to empty set or set of I is equal to 0. So now I can use the usual Nullstellensatz, so by the affine Nullstellensatz, we have that if I take the radical of I, this is, I mean, either I itself, and therefore the radical of I, if we are in the case of the empty set, will be the whole of kx1 to xn. x0 to xn. Or the radical ideal is, the radical of I is the set of all polynomials which vanish at 0, which is just the ideal generated by x0 to xn. So in any case, the radical of I contains this. So this is equivalent to saying that the radical of I contains x0 to xn. So thus, so if we have this, so for any, say, I from 0 to n, there exists a number ji such that, say, xi to the ji lies in I. No? And so I can take let n to be the, say, the sum of these ji's. Then we see, you know, as all monomials, so if I take any monomial now in the xi, which has degree at least n, then the powers of one of the xi's must be at least ji. So any monomial of degree at least n lies in I. In k x0 to xn lies in I. And so it follows that I contains all homogeneous polynomials of degree n for some n. But also, obviously, conversely, if it contains all homogeneous polynomials of degree n for some n, then its radical will contain x0 to xn. Because it, in particular, contains x0 to some power, and so on. So this is the first part. So this was this one little exception, which is also the more difficult part. And now the second part is quite easy. So let x to be, again, the zero set of I. And we now know that this is non-empty. Behind the case, it's non-empty. We want to prove something. So we just write down. So if I take the homogeneous ideal, what is it? We have seen that this is the ideal of the cone of X. And this is the same as the idea of the, say, affine zero set of I. I mean, the cone. So I take in an plus 1, I take the zero set of I. And we know. What? What?
X.
Yes. Yeah, X is a projective algebraic. I wrote something else. Yeah. Well, okay. I mean, in principle, I should have written the P here, you're right, because we have in the same two lines, the affine and the projective case. But, you know, if we're not in that situation, I'm free to write just Z in both cases. But obviously, you're right, that here I should write this because the next line I look also at the affine case. So, and we know, now, by the usual Nullsternsatz, that the ideal of the zero set of an ideal is the radical. By the Nullsternsatz. So you see, the projective, so this is the projective Nullsternsatz, or rather straightforward consequence of the affine one, if one knows the story about cones. We have this. This slight complication with the empty set, because you know, it's just the case that if we have a, you know, which comes from this relation with between the cones and the projective algebraic sets, because in order to talk about cones, we have to always add the zero, and this somehow messes up our argument here a little bit, and therefore also the statement. But otherwise, it's precisely the same as in the projective case. Yes? Okay. So actually, I maybe should have said it. So what we have said is something slightly different, which is equivalent. You know, I had said as a remark and exercise, so you have to disprove it if you don't want to believe it, that if, how is it? If the zero set of I is non-empty, then we have that, let me see. So what was the statement? Then we have that the, so if x equals to the zero set of I is non-empty, then we have that the cone of x, so this was the projective zero set, is equal to the affine zero set. This was one of the two statements I made. And then, by definition, if X is empty, then the cone of X, just by definition, is equal to zero. Okay? If you, you can put this together and say this. I mean, it's maybe not the most intuitive way of saying the statement, but it's equivalent. I mean, okay. Okay. So now I want to just close this up by a few remarks. So one thing is that we see that for the statement one, we got this this exception, which came from this idea here, no? That if the zero set is the empty set, we actually get that the radical of I will contain this. And so we say that the ideal x0 to xn is called the irrelevant ideal. So it's a kind of a radical ideal which has the property that it has this zero set is still empty, although it's not the whole of kx1 to x, so it somehow doesn't do anything. And so we have this corollary. We have a 1-1 correspondence to a bijection. We have inverse bijections between the homogeneous radical ideals. So and. If I in K x 0 to x n is an ideal, say, which is not the irrelevant ideal, different. We call it relevant. Kind of stupid, but anyway. So we take the homogeneous relevant radical ideals. In kx0 to xn are in 1-1 correspondence by these two things. We can take its projective zero set, and we get a projective algebraic set in Pn. And if you have a projective algebraic set, we can go back and take its homogeneous ideal. And this gives us bijections between the homogeneous radical ideals in x1, x0 to xn, and the projective algebraic sets in Pn. The only thing is, in order that it's really bijection, and we don't miss out one ideal, we have to throw away the irrelevant ideal, which comes from this statement here. Okay. And as a corollary, we get the same thing that we had in the fine case, that the that a projective algebraic set is irreducible if it's a zero if it's a zero set of a prime ideal, homogeneous prime ideal. So, proposition a projective algebraic set X, empty set in Pn, is irreducible if, so X is a zero set of I, where I in kx0 to xn is a homogeneous prime ideal. So it's a homogeneous ideal, which is also a prime ideal. And then, as a straightforward consequence, if f is a homogeneous irreducible polynomial, and irreducible, then we have that its zero set is irreducible. So the second statement follows in the same way from the first as before. It's just that if f is irreducible, then the ideal generated by f is a prime ideal, and then we apply the first part. So to prove it, we only have to prove the second. And that's, you know, we proved a similar thing in the affine case. So the proof is analogous. It's only slightly complicated by the fact that we have to somehow talk about homogeneous polynomials. So we somehow, you know, have to, we have something about that something, if something is a product of polynomials, then if a product of polynomials lies in I, then one of them must lie in I. But in order to do this with a homogeneous case, we somehow have to make the polynomials homogeneous. And so this needs some tiny extra argument. But it's not a big deal. So first, assume X is irreducible. So is reducible. So we then we have to show that the ideal of that this is not prime. Just see. Yeah, so it appears, I'm pretty sure that this statement is also true, but this is not what I'm claiming. So I will maybe stick to what I claim so that I don't have to, you can see whether you can prove this. No, but I think I will stick to it. I will just prove it as is. So then, I think I have to. That is, that's what I have in my notes. I think what's written here is also true, but as I haven't worked out the proof, I will stick to what I have. So it's irreducible if and only if I of x is a prime ideal. This is a somewhat less useful statement, but that is what I have proven. Not quite sure. I think in that case, it's not so evident. I think to be on the safe side, I will want let's see. So assume x is reducible, then it follows that we can write x equal to x1 union x2 for closed subsets x1 strictly contained in x and x2 strictly contained in x. So we have two closed subsets whose union is x, but none of them is equal to x. Well, it follows then, obviously, that if I take the cone of x, this is the cone of x1 union the cone of x2. No? Because the way the cone is defined, this is evident. And these are both closed subsets of the cone of x. And none of them is equal to the cone of x, because this is not true here. So these are closed subsets with C of x1 and C of x2 is strictly contained in C of x. Okay. So it follows that C of x is reducible. So it follows that the homogeneous ideal of x, which is equal to the ideal of the cone of x, is not a prime ideal. Okay, so that was quite simple. Now we want to go the other direction. So we assume the ideal of x is not prime. So I just write I for it. So that means there exists element f and g in I such that, so in kx1 to xn, such that f times g is in I, and f and g are not in I. So now, normally you would say, you'd want now to work with f and g, take the intersection of x with the zero set of f and the zero set of g, and then we would conclude in the same way as in the fine case. The only problem is that we want to talk about, zero sets of homogeneous polynomials, so we would need that these are homogeneous polynomials. But you know, there's no reason why they should be, because you know, we haven't. That's not part of being a prime idea that you can do that. So we want to somehow replace f and g by homogeneous polynomials. On this, this is by looking at homogeneous components. So let fi. So let I and j be some positive, non-negative integers, minimal, such that the I, the homogeneous component of f of degree I is not an I, and the homogeneous component of degree j of g is also not an I. We have that f and g are both not an I. So if all their homogeneous components were an I, then f and g also would be an I. So there must be some smallest degree for which the homogeneous component is not an I. No? So this certainly exists. Now, so subtracting homogeneous components of F from F and of G, so of lower degree, from F and G, we can assume that F starts in degree I, and G starts in degree J. Why is that? You know, we know that all the homogeneous components of F of lower degree than I actually lie in the ideal I. So if I subtract them, I don't change the fact that F does not lie in I. You know, as this thing itself, you know, if I have the sum of two elements in I, then so if I take something which is not in I and I subtract from it something which is in I, then afterwards it's also not in I, because I is an ideal, and the same here. So we find that if we subtract the lower degree homogeneous components from F and G, what we get afterwards is still not an I. So we can replace F by what we get from, by subtracting it, and then F starts in degree I, and the same G in degree J. So, but now we have that Fi times Gj is the homogeneous component of minimal degree in F times G, of F times G. Now, if we take if we multiply things, the degree will add. And the lowest possible degree that we can get is if we take the lowest degree part here and the lowest degree part here. If we take one of them a higher degree, we get the higher degree. So the part of degree I plus j of f times g is this product. But now, now one has to remember that f times g is an element in I, and I is a homogeneous polynomial. An homogeneous ideal. So then by the definition of homogeneous ideal, an ideal is homogeneous if when an element lies in the ideal, then all its homogeneous components lie in the ideal. So therefore, also this lies in the ideal. And now we can argue in the same way as in the affine case. So we let X1 to be the zero set of I union, say, Fi. So we add, so we take the ideal I and we add to it this one thing. And X2, the zero set, so in other words, I could write it as set of I intersected zero set of Fi. X2 is the zero set of I intersected zero set of Gj. Well, we know that, you know, as Fi is not in the ideal of X, it follows that this is strictly contained in X. But on the other hand, we know that if I take their union, then this corresponds to taking the product here. We have that the product of these two elements is Fijj, which lies in I. So it's the same as the zero set of I. So it follows that, and the zero set, so X1 union X2 is equal to X. So thus, X is reducible. So now, from this, one can actually deduce what I wrote on the blackboard as part one, namely that if I is a homogeneous ideal, so this would be in some sense part two, so this should be, so if we have in the, look at the theorem or this proposition, we have this which I called part two. This should in some sense be part three. And the thing which I first wrote on the blackboard would be part two. So if I in k x0 to xn is a homogeneous ideal, with a homogeneous prime ideal, with a zero set of I is empty, is non-empty, then it follows that this zero set of I is irreducible. And this part two follows in the same way as in the affine case, because in the affine case we had seen that, you know, because we have this correspondence, radical prime ideals are radical, so that if we have this homogeneous prime ideal with this property, then this is actually the ideal of its zero set, and therefore part one applies. And then part two follows from part three follows from part two directly in the same way as in the affine case, because if you have an irreducible homogeneous polynomial, it generates a homogeneous prime ideal, and therefore part two applies. Okay. Okay. Ah, so my time is already up. I was a bit slower today. But in some sense, that's maybe just as well, because this finished the first part of this course, which was, you know, introduction of affine projective varieties. And the next time we will start to talk about, morphisms. So, I mean, the idea is that when you study something, say, vector spaces, manifolds, and whatever, so one of the main things you use to study it is the maps between these things which are compatible with the structure. So linear maps between vector spaces or continuous maps between topological spaces. And so, you know, and now we have to define what are the maps between varieties which are compatible with the structure of being a variety. And these maps we'll call morphisms. You know, a bit little, not so much fantasy. And somehow very important in the definition is to say what are the maps from a variety just to K, to the field. These we would call the functions, the regular functions. We'll actually find out that the way to define the morphisms is to say something about what they do to the functions. And therefore, we first have to look at the functions. OK, and we start this next time.